We've got with us in the studio Christian Osengale. He's a social worker, public affairs analyst, and is also a political analyst. Christian, thank you so much for joining us on the program.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Duke.
Good to have you here. Okay, so it's just 5 days to the election, and a whole lot is already there in the public space. Where people, some feel that there are clandestine moves, some Nicodemus moves to undermine the electoral process or skew it in some person's favor. Others feel otherwise, as is always the case. But one thing is certain, we have seen the highest level of political participation amongst Nigerians, especially the youths, in a long, long while. How all of that will be translated into actual votes is a different kettle of fish. Let's take off from there. Yes.
Well, it's a good thing that Nigeria have gradually metamorphosizing to this stage we are now. Now, considering the fact that in 1999, the Fourth Republic started, and to the glory of God, we have had a smooth sail over time. And that is a plus for Nigeria. And like whoever want to be Nicodemus in character, action, or with the plan to bring Nigeria down, I want to assure you that they will not succeed. Because the project, Nigeria project, is still very much in the hand of God. And that is my humble belief. And by the time Saturday will come, you're going to see how peaceful the election will be, and the result will be well accepted. I don't have to mind about that mindset I have. Because when you are planning to do the needful, some are planning to destroy the needful. But God knows exactly why he is there for all of us. Okay. You know, the bad people will be praying, let my will prevail. The good ones will be praying, let my will prevail. But in the final analysis, it is not how you pray or which way you pray. It is the decision of God himself that is final. As long as all of us have a supreme being that we worship, yeah, in one way or the other, whether you are a Muslim, traditional religious worship, a Christian, all of us have what we call a salvation panic. We want to make heaven. Okay. But whichever way the road we pass through to make the heaven is strictly to be determined by God. And absolutely, that is why the scripture rightly said that I, God, I will have mercy on who I want to have mercy upon. So it's not how you shout louder or you run faster or how you use some clandestine movements to get or shortcuts to get what you want,
okay,
that will determine this election.
Okay,
this election is going to be determined on the basis of the ideal.
All right, look at some undercurrents that have been playing out in the last couple of days. The fear scarcity is still there, even though we have supply now, but it's still within, it's still above the official regulated price, of official price by the federal government. And then you also have the issue of naira scarcity. In fact, that's the most thorny of all of them, because it touches the very fabric of our existence as a people. It touches on human existence, because it has to do with, you know, survival. So how do you look at these undercurrents in the build up to the election as challenges?
Well, for me, it's very, very much unfortunate that we have to navigate to this level where at this critical time we begin to experience all these challenges. You know, over time, I think since this administration came up, we hardly witnessed what they call fuel scarcity. But this period, when they program it to actually materialize in this period, I think some persons believe that is a sabotage from person unknown. Then, as we are trying to survive that trauma and tragedy, and the issue of currency came in again, and it's a double tragedy, but I want to believe that whoever is responsible, they will not succeed.
Okay, let me, Christian, once again.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for joining us on the special program, Nigeria Decides. Your opening remarks, you kept talking about prayers, 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 and It is believed that Nigeria is a country where so many people believe in prayers instead of actually walking. Looking at what the federal government has put in place, federal government has assured Nigerians that there will be adequate security for this election. Don't you think that is what we should have our confidence in? We should have our confidence in the federal government's ability to secure the polling units. Don't you think so?
Yes, yes. Like I said, as federal government is having that plan, even you see, not just of recent, some armory vehicles, military vehicles were bought, commissioned by the federal government to see that this election is peaceful. I want you to understand that at the same time, the evil planners are equally planning to derail the system, no matter the plan of government. But in all of this, that's why I said they will not succeed. Because if they are not succeeded since 1999, this 2023, they will not succeed. Now, you cannot take God out of all of this. Because like I said earlier, the evil man prays, the good man prays. It's God that will decide the prayer, he answers. You understand? So federal government is working assiduously to see that this election is peaceful. And we cannot take it away from the federal government. Some are already indicting the Buhari government for even being responsible for this hardship we are experiencing this time. But the man have said he certainly want to go and want to leave a legacy of a free and fair election. And I agree with him. Whether he's the one planning to do the good for the benefit of majority, somebody at his back is trying to truncate that wheel of progress that he has started. Well, time will tell. But the truth is that seeing his language over time, you know he's serious about giving Nigeria one of the best elections we have had in history.
Moving forward, so let me ask you a question about the politicking going on. Don't you think that what is happening now, we might be seeing increased participation in the voting process? Though INEC has said that 240 polling units have been cancelled, elections will not hold in 240 units across 28 states. And they've given their reasons that no voter, you know,
no voter came out to register.
Nobody registered in those polling units. But looking at what they call the Obidati, the third force. Before now, it used to be APC, PDP, you know. Though we have other political parties, but these two major parties seem to hold sway. But now we have other parties. We have Sowore has always been there, you know, and he's still making his moves. But the Labour Party factor, don't you think that will affect the electoral process this time around? We're going to see increased participation in the voting process. Don't you think so?
Without any other of that, you can see that it's already affecting the pattern the election is going, in the sense that increased participation.
Okay.
You can see every corner you go in. I just came back from Port Harcourt yesterday, Wednesday night. Every corner you enter, you discover that everybody is talking about this election. So the hype you have is a good domain for politics.
Yes.
And I want to thank God that in those days, people like Dengani Fohemi insisted and fought for multi-party system of government. Okay. And Nigeria have key into it. This is the result. You can remember how the man stood his ground, went to court, challenged the military, and we are reaping the benefits today. And unfortunately, he's not alive to see it, but he laid the foundation that we are reaping the benefit of today. But you understand, when you begin to see youth be showing this interest, it clearly tells you that something unusual has happened. Something unusual has actually happened, and we believe that the result of what has happened now, that you see this increase in awareness, in participation, in interest, certainly you are not going to see the result very just now. Certainly the result will come in the future. Not in this election. Not in this election.
Okay, let's quickly talk about the acceptability and response level that you want to see from the electorates in terms of the campaigns, the content of the campaigns, the agendas of the various political parties, if you like, call them manifestos. How would you assess that so far?
Yes, I think all the candidates have tried as much as possible to be very careful. Let me use that word, careful, in presenting their manifesto. Some at the beginning was not too forceful about manifesto. Some I actually see themselves as the manifesto. But with pressure, that is why I said, when you begin to see utterances from man's movement, you begin to navigate towards that line. And the masses have compelled the politicians to do the needful so that good results will begin to show themselves. So you see, each of the candidates has his own manifesto. And most of them at their various town hall, at the rallies, have tried to explain to the people what they want to do. Now, it is not left for us as voters, who are actually supposed to be the commander-in-chief at this stage.
The kingmakers.
Yes, to decide who gets the mandate. And this is the time I want to appeal to all Nigerians 18 years and above that are registered, not to think that their vote will not count. Let's combat massively and make a point that Nigerians are always there to make the difference. And by the time you see the percentage of voters surpassing what we have over the time, you will now know that the foundation, what, like I said earlier, the manifestation of what is happening now, the foundation will be laid. Because when the time comes, you see that most of all these things that you are seeing around, whether obedient, obedient, whatever, you begin to see in future. It might not be Obi that will wear the crown, like the case of Ghani I said now. He may not be, but who knows? I think this 2023 election will arrange the stage for how democracy is practiced in Nigeria.
Yeah, you seem to be so emphatic that this increased awareness, especially the participation of the youths in Benin City in particular, during the when publicity was made for persons who register to collect their PVCs, some youths organized carnival, even at the museum ground, to encourage residents to go collect their PVC. You know, they paid for it, they sponsored it. And you are saying that the result will not be gotten in this 2023 election. I seem not to agree with you. Don't you think this election, we are going to see a difference, a landmark shift from what used to happen in elections? Now, before now, thuggery was a problem. Political talks. Now, the introduction of beavers is expected to eliminate that. And who are the thugs? Before now, some youths were hired as thugs. And the youths are saying they would vote this time around and that they will be involved. In other words, they are not ready to be thugs, but rather they want to be patriotic citizens. And you still maintain that the result, the end product of what we are seeing now, this increased politicking, increase awareness, will not be got in this election? You want to change your stance?
No, it depends on the perspective you want to look at it. If you want to be practical, you are saying the voice that is so pronounced in this revolution is the obedient voice.
I'm not saying that.
No, I'm telling you. If you even look at the social media, you know that it's the obedient voice. But the last registration of INEC, we have just about 10 million new addition. And a critical microscopic view of those 10 million shows that all those new voters does not belong to the new entrants. And if you visit most of all these INEC offices, the cars that have not been collected are huge. You understand? I just see a flash at the end of INEC certifying agents across the country. You describe that the list of agents that you have on board, the movement is the lowest. Now, why I say it's going to be far different from before, in the last 2019 election, we have two major candidates, Buhari and Atiku. Then on social media, all other 71 political parties that were represented by presidential candidates, on social media, none of them have less than 3 million followers on social media. By the end of the election, a lot of them combined could not garner about 1.5 million votes. So those are statistics that are there. But what we're going to have now is we are going to see that outside those two main political parties, we are going to see increase, massive increase of voters that will certainly be more than 1.5 million, different from what we used to see before. When I see that foundation laid in this election, if I am the leaders of those that kickstarted this movement, we are going to build on that foundation to change the narrative in future. Okay. That is why I said it may not materialize now.
Okay. Now, the feeling is that even though the analysis given, the analysis is quite possible, plausible about the new registrants by INEC in the region of about 10 million, many of these people that have been very active on social media, they were not captured. Perhaps they probably don't have PVC. But the feeling is that there are people who belong to these so-called major political parties who are also distressed with what is happening in the country by virtue of the insecurity, by virtue of the economic situation and all of that, that have made up their mind that this is who I'm going to vote for by virtue of all of these things we're talking about. I recall recently, Edo State Governor Gordon Obaseki in a forum said, you'll be shocked that even in your house, there's always an obedient person in your house, in your family. So it's not just about the social media thing. It's not just about what is there in the public space. This is becoming an ideology reflective of some of the shortcomings that we've had in the country over the years. Otherwise, why are we even talking about the obedient movement? Why are we even talking about the Obidati collaboration? Why is it not a major subject of discussion? Why is it a major subject of discussion?
Yeah, because it's a major subject of discussion because the Obidati movement was already on ground on the platform of the third force he mentioned.
Okay.
So fortunately for Obi himself, he met the foundation and he became the flag bearer of that foundation.
Okay.
Because there was already a conglomeration of different mindsets who believe that it cannot be status quo. So there need to be a third force.
Okay.
So the third force, we already planned, they were already strategizing when Obi was spending money to contest under PDP.
Okay.
You understand? So because something happened along the line, in that platform could not work. So he has to fall back. And before he landed, he landed on that platform that was already there.
Okay.
When you look at the revolution that have taken place in the world, look at the French Revolution. It is not the period that you light the matches that you see the result.
Okay.
That is my belief.
That's the reason why you're saying that all of these probably will bear more fruits in the future.
When on the ground again, let me even put a clause. On the ground that the protagonists of this movement have a mindset.
Let me just take you on this point. I know my colleague wants to ask you another question. The feeling that of all the presidential candidates, Obi seems to have been outstanding in engaging the issues of development economy. For example, he says he wants Nigeria to be a production hub, or like what used to be in the past. That is a very, very direct response to one of the most critical challenges that we have in the country that has made Nigeria a dumping ground for all kinds of things, including toothpicks. So I like to get your take on that, because the feeling is that this seems to be the reason why you have a lot of people swaying to the Obi movement or being influenced by the Obi-Dati collaboration because of provision of answers. For example, you were given an analysis on the registration that INEC did, the number of people that registered and all of that. It made sense to us more because you quoted figures. We have seen Obi do that on a number of occasions in addressing policy issues. We don't hear that from the other presidential candidates. Yes.
Well, let me borrow my Abololo company. Let me borrow their word to say that is Obubuyaya. Obubuyaya in the sense that when you hear Obi talk like that, you cannot give what you don't have. You look at what are those foundations that he laid that you can refer to that I did it before. But before we come back there, you remember that even when current president came, he talked about those things Obi is talking about now. And that is why today, toothpick is being produced in Nigeria. Even matches. Before now, you remember when Buhari came, he talked about banning that 43 items that central bank governor, if anybody wants to import those 43 items, they should go and look for dollars themselves. Nobody should make dollars available for them. And that is why you begin to see production going up. And today we can proudly say that Nigerian rice is wonderful.
At what cost?
No, the cost is relative.
At what cost? It's not relative. At what cost?
Let me say.
The bag of rice that was 8,000 naira is being sold for the 5,000 naira, for the 6,000 naira.
Those of us that understand the mechanism of that bag of rice that was sold 8,000 naira. Mm. The good news is that even at that time, I don't eat the rice. Mm. Since over time, I've been used to Ekpoma rice and Agbede rice.
Yes.
It's when the bag was 2,000.
Which is also very expensive now.
No, it has to be expensive because there are so many factors that you put in place.
No, we should have expected that with this level of production, we should produce enough to feed ourselves.
Yes.
And so in such a way and manner that the price will go up. When supply is high, what happens? And we don't see that happening.
Let me give you a secret. You may not understand why I want to say this, but looking at the challenge of the global economy today, I want to tell you, if not that this government take that decision of trying to eat what we grow, by now that 8,000 naira bag of rice, if you hold 100,000, you will not even see it to buy. If you want to know, just go to Ghana, you get a proper understanding of what I'm talking about.
What's happening there?
The economy is down. Even the you describe that the purchasing power is nothing to rhyme about, because.
But the currency is still higher.
It's not.
It's higher than Nigeria.
No, it's
currency.
Not. I was in Ghana
some time ago, and then I can't remember how many CDs we ate. I and Dizzo interviewed the wife of former President Jerry Rawlings. He was contesting one of the political parties for the presidential election. And then when we finished eating, and then they gave us a bill. They brought a bill. When we converted the bill to Nigerian currency, it was 22,000. I stood up. You mean we just spent 22,000 for just a meal?
I don't know the time you are talking
about. So I'm giving you the scenario. This is a practical experience.
Yes, I don't know how many years ago. I'm talking of the reality. I don't know if you listen to a report from China that China, because of this global challenge, is experiencing the highest rate of inflation in 42 years.
Yeah.
Britain is in recession. Globally, there is a challenge.
Okay.
But the fact that Nigeria is still here means that revolution of eating what will grow make enough impact. Mm. But coming back to the Obubuyaya issue I talked about. Now, if I say I want to change the economy, but the good news is that I was a governor for 8 years in the state. Some of us took the bull by the horn to visit that state not too long ago.
Anambra State.
To see what are those variables on ground to really give the feeler that this, what I call Obubuyaya philosophy, will materialize. Honestly, maybe others will go and see, but me, I didn't see anything. Mm. The team of others went there, we didn't see anything. Now, there is an investigation on his own supermarket, Obi Supermarket. the anything you see there is from China imported. So I was thinking, if I want to make that philosophy or ideology that you talk about, I will start visiting all the villages in Nigeria, making sure that what we produce in Nigeria is in my supermarket.
Okay.
When all those things are on ground, you cannot, as you are bringing those Chinese philosophy, you cannot say, go to my supermarket, it's there. In Anambra State, in I did this, I did this. However, how can a Democrat that was a governor of a state in 8 years could not conduct local government election for 8 years until his party and PDP then push him to court? That court insist that he must come just 2 months to his office.
I must interject here.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have any Labour Party representative to defend these allegations. These are allegations now that are not we cannot authenticate or verify. So we must state here that Christian's statements are his personal opinion, does not reflect independent television and radio at all. So, but let me quickly add this. Now, we are not trying to be particular about any of the presidential candidates. We just brought in that there seem to be increased politicking because of the third force and all of that. So whatever Obi said he did in the States, I haven't gotten there. I haven't carried out any investigation. So anything you are saying now, I would not accept because I wasn't there. So it's your own personal opinion and perception. But let's address the issues. 5 days to the conduct of the election. Looking at the umpire, INEC has continued to give Nigerians the assurance that this election will be credible. The federal government also has given assurance in terms of security that this election will be peaceful. Just recently now, the NUC has ordered vice chancellors to close universities. Polytechnics also have been asked to be shut down so our students can also participate in this election. Looking at these factors, what are your expectations for this Saturday's election?
Before I answer that, let me say I'm not a baby anymore.
Yes.
I talk and I'm entitled.
It's your personal opinion, yes.
It's my personal opinion and I stand by it. And ITV does not have a say in what I say. Yeah. It is my personal opinion, and I have done my research. You can double what I said and find out. But I'm not here to speak for anybody. The reason why obedient should begin to crop up here, because we know, without deceiving ourselves, that he is the basis of this revolution we are talking about. You understand?
Yes.
So that is why he's cropping up.
And that makes him very, very special, because you see that many times when these issues come up, you always find people who wants to give the other side. Yeah. That means he's a very, very major force in this election.
Yeah, but
and
that is exactly to answer the question.
Yes, that's exactly what you're alluding to. That you even have to take the time to go and carry out a personal investigation to have other things to say.
Yes.
It means he's a major force. We cannot take that away. But you see, like you said, let's try and stay on course because we have very limited time to the issues that he raised in terms of assessment of INEC preparations and all of these issues, particularly other stakeholders in this election.
Yes, INEC have done the needful, and outside saboteurs, outside enemy of this country, within and outside this country, we have enemies.
Yeah.
Because if you are making progress, be rest assured, your enemy will just be coming up from right, left, and center.
The black man philosophy.
Yes, they are there. nobody wish. No, we in this part of the world, we believe this syndrome of pull him down syndrome is there.
That's why I said the black man
so
philosophy.
So there are people who wish INEC to fail.
Yes.
There are people who wish INEC not to succeed. And those people are not sleeping. But INEC too is not sleeping. And with the way INEC has carried on over the years, especially drawing close to this election, it is clear that INEC have put his house in order.
Okay.
And the other day, I saw Nene going to CBN, telling CBN, look, with the way things are, I hope you will not be the enemy that we are suspecting. And CBN assured INEC that no, they are not going to be the enemy. So we believe that anytime INEC identify these, whether imagine enemies, they should quickly go there and intervene. And I'm aware too, they have gone to the Transport Association to see that those ones are on board. They have visited security agencies across board. So they have done what they needed to do. And I am sure, I believe in people who have decided to pronounce a word, and their word is their bond. I believe I neck 100%, and I'm sure they will not fail Nigerians.
So if they are of universities, are you at home with it so that the students?
Yes, as long as as long as the closure does not exceed on Monday after the election, they should go back to school. Because one, I know that most students in school now registered in their various places, so it will be better so that we equally increase the mass participation of voters. It's a good idea, but they should not extend it beyond unnecessary.
March the 11th election.
Yes, March. You know, after this election, after
you said they should go back, they'll go back. They will be
come back and then
again,
go back again.
No, you see, it depends on the logistics.
Okay.
There's nothing that is not possible. 2 weeks. 2 weeks is a big plus for students. Taking it away from them is like you are cutting their throat. So I think they have more to lose if they remain at home in 3 weeks. They have more to lose. So there's nothing wrong if they go the other week, 2 weeks later they go back. I'm sure they will, considering the months of strike.
Yeah.
So it's necessary for them to do their permutation and calculation to see how these children are not kept away for too long.
Okay. Let's just talk about something that has been going on in the last couple of days. It revolves around this Naira swap deal. People find it difficult to have access to cash. And then there was a Supreme Court judgment that restrained the disposal of the old Naira notes, pending when the matter will be heard and the final conclusion is done. But just before the dust generated by that would settle, Mr. President gave a broadcast, in a sense, countering the judgment of the Supreme Court, directing CBN to continue to accept 200 Naira as a legal tender for another 60 days, and they're apparently jettisoning the usage of 500 Naira and 1,000 Naira. What do you make of this? Because the question that has arisen from that is respect for the court, especially the Supreme Court of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. People are beginning to make insinuations to this. People are beginning to make some extrapolations of the implications of these in the nearest future, because you know in law, you always cite precedents. Yes, let me get to take on this.
Well, unfortunately, I'm not a lawyer. With my
elementary knowledge.
Rudiment knowledge of law, I think, first, the president have legal advisors. The CBN has, and the court is there. But what I want to bring out from what happened.
Yes.
The Supreme Court is the final authority of law in Nigeria. But I'm aware that they don't make law. They interpret the law. And some school of thought legally are saying that the law establishing central bank and the law that gave them the power to do this is statutory, is there. No courts can alter the law. And the other school of thought is saying, since Supreme Court equally have the power to set precedents, which become law in itself, they have the authority to take the decision.
Okay.
I think since the legal debates, or I mean, they're still in the court. They have not withdrawn the case. Let's see how the Supreme Court finally take his decision. But I want to appreciate the president for that announcement, because after the announcement, you observe that the tension from 99.9% reduced to about 70%.
Okay.
Because those of us that were still having the old naira note 200, 500, and 1,000, now, you know, most of us pass through it, waiting for when central bank will ask for it.
Yes.
So once that announcement was made, some of us now went back to begin to take away the 200 naira note so that we can add it for use. And that one somehow reduced the tension in the land.
Yes.
But I want to say it's actually a good policy. The implementation may be 40.
Mm. And because, the timing too.
And the timing may not be. Mm. But the point is this. You see, when government make policies, unfortunately, maybe they have bad marketers. Mm. They don't know how to sell down the thing.
Yeah, but because government said they made a policy to checkmate the incidence of vote buying. Because some governors, politicians, candidates have amassed so much wealth, so much money in their homes, to buy the electorate. And that's a major problem in our electoral process.
Duke, that is my joy. That is why I'm happy.
That what?
That the timing is wrong. It's not wrong at all.
Okay.
Because otherwise, you would have been, in fact, most of us may not have been able to even go to the street with if those money were available. You know what Central Bank said? Out of 3.2 trillion that was supposed to be in the control.
In circulation,
they only have 5 billion.
500 billion.
Mm. And now with this more pop exercise, about 2.2 trillion has come back to the banking system. Okay, when you have one third of 2.2 trillion, there will be revolt. There will be mass uprising. The politician probably plan to destroy this country because they will pile up this money. What for? They are waiting for election. So the timing is not wrong at all. But this process, this policy was actually planned for about 7 years ago, if I'm not mistaken. The times this government introduced POS machine.
Mm.
POS machine simply means point of sales.
Yeah.
So if I am a tomato seller, I'm supposed to have it by my side. Even pure water seller, any businessman, point of sales means At the point of sale, you should have it.
By your side.
Mm. So if about 7 years ago, all of us have, you know,
embraced this policy.
Yes. Nobody cares about holding money. It is the big men, this person that want big cash, either to lure people or to deceive people. But me and you, if you have 1,000, 10,000 in our pocket for a week, it may still be there. You understand? So it is these big politicians who have made this country dry, that are complaining more. But they push us forward so that we complain on their behalf, and some of us are keen to it. They are the ones suffering it. For example, now, with 200 naira, if I go to bank and withdraw 200,000, and they give me 200 naira, I need the trailer to carry it.
But sister, let me interject again. Now, I had a conversation with a politician yesterday, and he made some very, very valid points. Now, he doesn't believe that these new currency introduced by the CBN will affect anything in terms of the strategies of politicians.
Like vote buying.
He said that transfer through the phone, through the banking app on your phone, that politicians can just distribute money to their agents.
Mm.
And all they still need to do is convince you and say, will you vote for my party? Give me your account number. That is even safer for them because security agents will not be able to arrest them at the different polling units because they'll be carrying cash, like you have said. And that they will not carry cash now. They'll just be making transfers from one account to another, influencing and trying to induce.
So that's digital vote buying.
Something like that. So what do you think about that? What do you think that's possible?
I think the politician is trying to be economical with the truth. Maybe you call him again and advise him that he should be careful on how many transfer he does. Mm. Because there is a BVN.
Mm.
So if you transfer, every agent of a political party is registered by INEC. So by the time you begin to transfer to masses of agents, time will come, you will explain to government how come you now have all these agents that INEC does not even know.
Mm.
So if he, let me advise him, he should be careful on how many times he make transfer and who is making the transfer to. Mm. Because everything has purpose.
Yeah.
The law says, if I have the capacity to take money to the bank, like let's say 100,000, I can only do so once a week. So if I have the capacity to transfer to us, like one politician was saying on television, was it not yesterday, that I need 70 million or 700 million, according to law, to pay his agent. Now, if you are using to pay agent, you can do transfer, but make sure you work strictly with the number of agents allotted to you. So if you not talk of buying vote, how many people are you going to transfer to? You understand?
Okay.
It's going to be very, very difficult for them. That is the truth. But at the end of the day, they are deceiving us by that language, so that we will be the one pressuring government to drop the policy. Okay. And the thing will not favor us. It will favor them on the long run.
Yes.
You understand? It is better. Those who are crying more in Nigeria today are those who have buried enough money on the Sokeway. When you remove that huge amount from economy, you have killed that economy. In fact, I now know that we are still existing as a country by the grace of God. Mm-hmm. Taking 2.7 trillion away from Nigeria economy, and Nigeria surviving with just 500 billion, it simply means it was a miracle that Nigeria is still where we are today.
I saw a story. I couldn't really independently verify the story. A certain state governor, I don't want to mention name now, was alleged to be owing about 6 months worker salaries, and he didn't pay. But with this naira redesign swap policy that CBN brought, he brought all the monies out in cash and paid the workers the 6 months salary that he was owing. I also saw a video online where a governor's wife, you know, brought that money and was giving to security aids.
Cash.
You know, that should be about a million or above a million naira, giving them out cash. All these monies have been stockpiled over the years in Sokeway tanks, underground tanks, overhead tanks, just name it. Because they believe that a time like this will come where they will get these monies out and then, of course, use it for their advantage. This is why this policy is very timeous to addressing some of these issues that we are seeing in the country. Except that the component of the policy that has a direct bearing on the masses, the common man on the street, perhaps was not really well thought out. And that's how we saw that kind of reaction that grew. But it's okay, we hope that ultimately it will work well for this country. Another major issue that is quite it's worth talking about is the issue of fake news. I mean, just yesterday, we saw a barrage of fake news. First was the story that one of the presidential candidates had over 800 billion in his house. President Buhari has instructed EFCC to read the house. In fact, they've got to read all of that. And I saw that story and I was just laughing. And well, thank God that a few minutes later, the EFCC responded to debunk that story. I'd like to get a take on this.
Yes, those such story will be much more.
Okay.
They will come because there are what we call conflict entrepreneur in peace and conflict studies. We call it conflict entrepreneur. They survive when there are crises. Okay. Outside crisis, they don't survive. So you will see such people throwing up such challenges. Mm. If you observe even this period that you have this this policy on,
yes,
the news kidnapping has reduced.
Okay.
So those who begin to hear fake news, this is the time and this is the era. Fake news can lead. Fake news, remember, the major problem of Rwanda was fake news. That they have to, close to 1 million people died because of fake news.
Yeah.
So fake news has the capacity to burn a whole country.
Yeah.
So people are waiting for this country to be on fire. So they will throw up those things. And I pray that some of us that have the God to analyze such fake news we're not listening to such fake news, so that we'll move forward as a people.
All right, thank you very much, Christian Osagale. It's been a delight having you here.
Thank you so much.
I hope next time we invite you, you also oblige us.
I will.
Well, not very many people have the capacity to be on a live program of this magnitude to engage issues even on a very short notice. It really doesn't have to do with your academic background, but it's a special gift, quality, capacity, and ability that you must have to be able to engage issues. Well, some, you invite them, they give you your words or give you their words that they are coming, but when it mattered most, they just chicken out, and it's quite frustrating. But somehow we will continue to engage the issues, put them in the right perspective for us to ensure that the electorates are well informed so they don't take deformed decision or deformed action. The collectivity of our actions will actually make Nigeria a better place as far as this election is concerned. Usambola, last word.
Okay, closing remarks on the program, Monday's edition of Nigerian Decides. I must state here that the enthusiasm, optimism of the voters we must commend. And the policy of this present administration of President Muhammadu Buhari must be commended as well, because some persons have been able to dissect the policy, taking into cognizance the overall benefit to the citizens, to the country, and also to the conduct of the election. It is believed that this policy redesigning of the Naira notes will help curb not only corruption, not only insecurity, but vote buying. Our analyst has also analyzed, and some persons have said, oh, no, transfers through the banking app in the phone can be done, and it has been dissected here that it will be cumbersome. So I think that this election, at the end of the conduct on Saturday, it is not only a presidential election, don't forget, it's also an election for the National Assembly. We are going to be having senators. We are going to be having members of House of Representatives who are closer to the grassroots, closer to the people. So it is my expectation that at the end of the conduct of the presidential National Assembly election on the 25th of February 2023, the outcome will be generally accepted by Nigerians, because some of the factors that have militated against credible elections would have been eliminated.
Okay.
You have a wonderful week ahead.
All right. Christian, last word.
Well, I thank God for Nigeria. I want to appreciate the common man. They should love themselves more than these big people. These people don't love them. They only push them to throw the stone, like they have distressed some bank now, and big men push them so that the government can change their mind. I want government to stick to the policy. In the final analysis, it will benefit us all, and Nigeria will be a better place for all of us to live in.
Okay, that's our dream, that's our aspirations, that's our prayer, that Nigeria becomes a better place for us all to live in. That can only happen when we take action. That's our package for today on Nigerian Decides. We'll be here tomorrow again at 7 a.m. with a fresh edition of the program. On behalf of the entire crew, this is wishing you a great week ahead, and ensure that you get ready for Saturday, the D-Day for Nigerian Decides. Bye for now.